Welcome to Witness, where we bring you the best documentaries from around the world, stories told from a personal perspective. I'm Rida Fakhri.
Russia has waged a brutal war against Chechen separatists since the 1990s. But what started as a nationalist independence movement soon became a rallying cry for Islamist militants around the world who wanted to establish an Islamic state in the North Caucasus. The separatists defeated the Russian army, but 4 years later, the Russians came back with a vengeance. At the same time, some former rebels, like the Republic's current president, Ramzan Kadyrov, changed sides in opposition to the militant Islam of some of the separatists. Russia now claims to have finally defeated the rebels, but resistance continues, and many who survived the battles and fled to exile outside Chechnya still live in fear of their lives. They are Chechen fighters.
This is my homeland, Chechnya. Most of the world has forgotten, but a war is still being fought there. I live in the UK now, but I used to be a fighter in the Chechen resistance against Russia. I can't tell you my name. I can't show you my face or my wounds. I can't even let you hear my voice, because I still have relatives in Chechnya, and I'm afraid of what the Russians might do to them if I reveal my identity. Spring is starting now in Britain, as it is in Chechnya. It reminds me of my country, the area where I grew up. Chechnya was a beautiful country, with so many hopes for the future. But they were destroyed, smashed. Images like these have been shot by Chechen fighters, people I know or knew. It's their way of getting around the Russian restriction on reporting from Chechnya and letting the world know that the war isn't over yet. We have fought against Russian occupation for centuries. We even had our own Holocaust. Stalin deported the entire population east during the Second World War. A third of all Chechens died in the process. My parents were born in Kazakhstan, and so many of the population died during that deportation. They were forced out of their homes without even proper clothing. And 50 years later, it happened again. It's been happening all the time since we started to live with the Russians. So when the Soviet Union broke up in 1991, Chechnya was quick to declare its independence. And when Russia invaded 3 years later, I was one of the first to join Chechen army. It was my duty, to be honest, and I can't imagine my destiny without having been a part of that. When I was growing up as a boy of 10, 15, the heroes in books I was trying to make my role models were all fighters against the Russian invasion. But the amazing thing is that after 2 years we won that war. We beat the biggest army in Europe. For 3 years we had a kind of independence, and then Russia invaded again. This time bigger, harder. I was wounded at the beginning of the Second War in an ambush. We were driving and suddenly people started shooting. I tried to escape the car I was in and start shooting back. I was hit straight away. My head, legs, body. We were just going to check the way to see if it was safe for others to travel. It wasn't. Up to 200,000 people have been killed in the two wars. That's a fifth of our population. Russia now controls most of Chechnya, and Mr. Putin has declared mission accomplished. But he still keeps troops in this small country, because the resistance fights on from its mountain strongholds. I'm on my way to meet another fighter. Because the Chechen community here is so small, he would be easy to identify, so I shall call him Chengiz. Like me, he has to hide his face and his voice. I met Chengiz during the First War. Salam alaikum.
Alaikum salam.
I was studying in Russia before the First War broke out. And when the war started, I left my studies and returned home. I always had good knowledge of our history from my father's stories. How our men would take up arms to defend the country against Russians. I was wounded at the beginning of the Second War and was taken out of Chechnya. I've been getting news from the Chechen resistance through tapes and messages.
Cengiz fought with one group in the resistance. I fought in another. These are messages sent to me. How life changes people. Izrudin, the guy on the left, he was so young, such a naughty boy. I always used to tell him off for speeding around in his car, for arguing, just behaving like a kid. And here, he's a grown man, talking like a grown man, ready to die for something. What amazing destinies people have. I sent them 10 watches in the end, just before Izrudin was killed. He was captured. They put out his eyes, cut his nose and ears, broke every bone in his body. They wanted him to betray the resistance. When his village got his corpse, people said it was the most mutilated body they've seen from both wars. After I was wounded, my brothers, I had 5 of them, started to join the rebels. One was killed without even participating in anything. He was taken away from his home. We never heard about him again. That caused my other brothers, one after another, to join the resistance. And they were killed after that. When the third one died, I took away from that town the 2 youngest brothers just because I knew their attitude to what's going on would be the same, if not stronger. One of them decided to go back, and I couldn't stop him. He went back to Chechnya and he died. With my youngest brother, I managed to get him married. He was in love with a beautiful lady. And as soon as I found out, I decided that would be the way to keep him away from the war. I collected some money and my friends helped me and we arranged a kind of wedding ceremony. And now he lives with his wife and kid. He's got a son who was named after his older brother. Like my 4 dead brothers, young people go to the mountains and join the resistance whenever the commanders need them. That's Aslan Mashadov. Cengiz served under him. He was elected president of Chechnya in 1997. Mashadov said to continue this war, to be effective against Russia, all he needed was 1,500, 2,000 people. No more. The more you've got, the more visible you become. The people in balaclavas are hiding their faces because they have to go to towns to see their relatives, to bring back information. Mashadov was our most moderate leader, the one the Russians could negotiate with, but they didn't want to negotiate and killed him in 2005. Many of them died. I have so many memories of these people, who they were before the war and how they ended up.
That's Muhammad Amin. He was a farmer. 12 members of his family have been killed. And that's Ahmad Abdurhanov. He was my commander. Ahmad was just a farmer too. Just a normal civilian. He wasn't a professional soldier. But he became a brigadier general. Ranks and positions don't play a great role in the resistance. Here you see a leader preparing food for his soldiers. Ahmad was an ordinary man who would never offend anyone. He always tried to be a friendly. Everybody loved him. Even those who fought him didn't say anything insulting about him. He was a truly heroic man, respected by his enemies.
That will work.
Before the war, for most people, religion was only important during weddings and funerals. But the Russians forced us into a corner, and now the fighters have turned to Islam as something to keep them going. We are not extremists, but we all pray now.
Join me again after the break here on Witness. Welcome back to Witness. I'm Rida Fakhri.
Chechnya has made little news in recent years, but fighting is still going on in this remote mountainous region of the Caucasus, and the rebels are still prepared to die for their beliefs. In a moment, my colleague Raghe Omar will be talking to Tony Wood, who's written extensively on the subject of Chechnya. But first, let's return to the inside story of the Chechen fighters.
You know what he said once? I doubt if there's anyone in Chechnya who's more scared of the war than me. Only these two are still fighting. This one died. This one died also, and this one. This one was captured, and I don't know about him.
The deaths of so many of our friends mean that we no longer get the personal videos we used to. The war continues, but the videos we are watching now are 2, 3, 4 years old. These days we have to get most of our news by phone.
There's Ahmad on the phone to me. After I left Chechnya, I was often asked to phone another group and then tell Ahmad about their situation. I talked to him 2 or 3 hours before he died.
Old friends die and new ones are made. This is Mansour. I heard about him in Chechnya, but we only met in the UK. He was also a fighter, and he's the best cook amongst us.
Before the First War, I was a merchant. The Russians bombed civilians from the air, from tanks and artillery. I was captured and was brought somewhere and placed in a pit. It wasn't big enough to sit. You end up in some sort of bent position. They would take me out when they wanted to torture me. Wires are connected to different parts of your body, your genitals and tongue. While running electricity through your body, they would stand there laughing, watching you in pain. You just want to die. The beatings almost never stop, and they always put a plastic bag over your head. When you lose consciousness due to lack of oxygen, they resuscitate you so that you can feel the pain. It has affected me deeply. When I go to bed, it's normal for me to wake up 3 or 4 times a night because of nightmares. It happened about 3.5 years ago. But for me, it happened yesterday.
Their tactics leave us with no choice. We are fighting for our survival. The world has shut its eyes to us, stating that Chechnya is an internal matter for Russia.
От базы муджахидов была обнаружена группа разведки муджахиды. Заняли позиции и сразу начали шквальный огонь.
Окружение.
How does it feel being in a situation like that? Not good. Initially you feel frightened a bit. It seems like every shot is pointed at you. You won't find a place to hide. Then, after 10, 15 seconds, you adapt to the situation and start acting, realizing what you are doing.
Yeah.
When you hear these shots, you can divide them into two parts. The long burst of fire means the Russians are shooting. And the shorter bursts mean the rebels are fighting back. The rebels have to economize to be careful with their ammunition. I'm wondering what happened to that squirrel. Ahmad's dividing them now in order to get out of the encirclement.
Конкретно поработали. Аллаху Акбар. Аллаху Акбар.
Перевязочный пакет нету каферский, да? Если есть, дай его, этот перевязочный пакет.
Пакет нету.
Ну, давай еще бинты давай.
У меня есть бинты.
There is nothing that these people have not seen that can scare them. Hunger, death, cold. But when someone dies who was so close for so many years, fighting alongside you, like all other humans, they feel the pain.
Muhammad Amin became the 13th member of his family to die in the war.
The dirty Russian policy in Chechnya leaves no place in my thoughts for my personal life. They have destroyed that.
I was lucky to get to the United Kingdom. Maybe one day I'll be able to go back home. I've got my old parents living back in Chechnya, and they live with orphans, the children of my brothers. I'm still hoping to find even a skull of my brothers. Because I know my mother will suffer the rest of her life from not being able to visit the graves of her sons. Within a year of burying Muhammad Amin, Commander Ahmad Abdurkhanov was also killed. Since I came to the UK, I've been studying. I wouldn't have been a fighter if it hadn't been for certain circumstances. Because even performing your duty, you make someone suffer. I'm doing a course next year about international conflict resolution because my concerns are about peace. My concerns are about ending the violence. Our experience at the hands of the Russians over the centuries means we'll never stop fighting for our independence. I would like to help find a more peaceful solution to that.
Recently, my colleague Rage Omar talked to author Tony Wood, who's written extensively on the subject of Chechnya.
Could you take us back to the beginning in some ways and explain to us exactly what the relationship between Russia and Chechnya was? I mean, during the time of the Soviet Union and during the time when Chechnya was created?
Certainly. I mean, Chechnya is on Russia's southern flank in the North Caucasus. And it was absorbed into the Russian Empire, as was in the early part of the 19th century. In Soviet times, it was an autonomous region of Russia. But then in 1944, Stalin deported the entire Chechen people to Central Asia, the ostensible reason for it being that they had collaborated with the Nazis, though there's very little evidence.
Well, the entire nation was just packed off?
Something like in order of 400,000 people were put on cattle trains and sent to Central Asia and Siberia, yes.
Right. And what is the situation today? I mean, obviously, two wars have been fought. I mean, huge numbers of sort of loss of life. But I mean, at the moment, I mean, where do we stand with regard to Russia and Chechnya?
At present, Chechnya is governed by Ramzan Kadyrov, who is a strong man who Russia put in place by force, effectively. He has no real democratic mandate, and he has a sort of rubber stamp parliament that was elected in rigged elections over the past few years. It's been reconfirmed, but none of these votes have real democratic legitimacy, I would say.
But the case that Russia continues to make and states is that it is trying to rebuild Chechnya and is pumping a lot of development money and you know, fixing the enormous amount of, you know, at least physical damage that was done to Grozny, the capital, and many other areas. Is that true?
Yes, I think it's true to a certain extent. I mean, reconstruction has taken place, but you have to remember that in many cases these buildings are little more than facades. They're new apartment buildings and they have double glazing, but once you get inside them there is no there are no water pipes, no electricity, and they're uninhabitable as apartment buildings, so they are in many cases purely for show.
As your book states, I mean, the war became a rallying cry for Islamists, I mean, not just in Chechnya but around the world. Where does the balance lie in terms of how a lot of the fighters see their cause now?
I think this is another complex issue, really, because the Chechens have got very small number of fighters of their own. I think the total number of resistance fighters can't be more than about 2,000 at the most. And of those, a certain proportion would be foreign nationals or fighters from other North Caucasian republics. So there has to be an element of appeal that broadens out the cause to include something others would be willing to fight for. But at the same time, the bulk of the fighters are Chechens themselves, and I think that their main goal would still be an independent state. The question of religion would then enter into that as in terms of what kind of state you want that to be.
Why has Chechnya, of all the sort of wars of succession, if you want to call them that, I mean, in the post-Soviet era, why has Chechnya been such a thorn in the side of Russia?
I think because the Russians don't have a solution for it, really. I think they've tried all the different forcible solutions they can, and they've tried imposing a political settlement, but it's not resolved the problem for them. And the one solution they haven't genuinely tried, which is to ask the people of Chechnya freely to decide what future they want for themselves, might produce an outcome that the Russians would find inadmissible, which would be independence. And I think they're too scared of asking that question, which would give you a real chance for peace, because they don't want to surrender the territory.
That's it for this edition. Thank you for watching, and I hope you'll join me next time here on Witness.